friend from England, and he was quite horrified at what he saw as the misrepresentation of English history at that fair. And I was somewhat tickled by his horror, but then I started to think it would be seriously interesting to see, you know, to sort of think in an organized way about what use people are putting to that history as represented. What use people are putting to that history as represented. Because obviously, you know, their interests were not the same as his. So when I started to dig into it, first of all, I realized it went much further than I'd been thinking, and that, you know, as you said in the introduction, that it had a whole lot to do with the creation of what we now call the 60s.
So, Rachel, you make the point in the book that the Renaissance Fair actually helped the 60s counterculture grow, and you have some great pictures there from album covers of the Byrds and the Isley Brothers. Tell us how that happened. How did Renaissance Fairs fuel the 60s?
Well, it's really completely fascinating. I think that a lot can be told about the early fair. The first one was in 1963, by looking at one house. And the house is in the Laurel Canyon neighborhood of Los Angeles, you know, long known for hosting bohemian types. It was the home of two people, Doris and Bob Carnes, who were completely crucial to creating the early fair. And Doris Carnes had time to do this because, among other things, she was a blacklist. She was part of the Hollywood blacklist, so she wasn't working. The house then was soon owned by Mickey Dolenz of the Monkees. And the interest for me is that there's this point where those two generations of artists and activists overlapped in that neighborhood. And at the beginning, I heard you played, you know, Parsley, Sage, Rosemary, and Thyme, and you just mentioned the Byrds. The Byrds also moved to Laurel Canyon, part of that sort of high-flying rock and roll scene, immediately, you know, wrote a song that was basically a Valentine to the fair. So you have this older generation of Hollywood people and this new generation of rock and roll artists who were sort of teaching each other how to create the early fair.
Mm-hmm. And so why is the nostalgia for the Renaissance in particular? On the face of it, the Renaissance seems like a really unlikely fit with the 60s. There wasn't a big women's rights movement during the Renaissance, obviously, and they didn't even have good plumbing. So why would anyone want to go back there?
Well, people weren't as interested in plumbing, but that's a very good question, especially because, you know, the early fair, one of the things that I really found there strongly was an interest in sort of experimenting with new gender roles and new family arrangements and sexual nonconformity as well. The Renaissance Fair sort of grew out of a children's theater program in which the Italian Commedia dell'arte was the most popular part for the kids. And then the woman who founded the fair, Phyllis Patterson, thought, well, what if we could do this as a real fair and sort of staged it more broadly with musicians and crafters and, you know, performers and food and all of the rest. The whole thing was presented, at first it was a benefit. There was a radio connection. It was a benefit for the first public radio station, Pacifica Radio. It's Los Angeles station.
Right.
And so what you've said just really hits at it, sort of taking what they found useful from history and also adding in what was important to their own values.
Right. And now we see some interesting things there.